morning, students. In continuation to instrumental methods of analysis, the second one is potentiometry. Let us see what is potentiometry. Is an electrochemical technique in which the amount of substance in solution is determined by measuring the change in potential or EMF. What is potential or EMF? You already come across in module 1. Let us repeat it. What is the potential or cell potential? It is the potential difference between the two electrodes of a galvanic cell which causes the flow of current from one electrode to the other. It is called as cell potential or EMF. Here also we are going to construct a cell in which potential is measured. That is what the basis. Here let us look into the principal part of this experiment. The redox titrations are carried out potentiometrically by measuring the EMF by combining two electrodes. One is platinum electrode, another one is calomel electrode, which is acting as reference electrode. By using this electrode combination, we are going to do the redox titrations potentiometrically. So here, what happens here is, when a pair of electrodes are placed in sample solution, shows the potential by the addition of the titrant or by the change in concentration of ions. Here, one of the electrode, that is platinum, is called as indicator electrode. Why it is called as indicator electrode? Here, platinum electrode is called as an indicator electrode. An indicator electrode is one at which the electrode potential varies as a function of solution concentration, is used to indicate the concentration of the solution species and is termed as indicator electrode. Generally, as said, platinum electrode is used as indicator electrode. This electrode acquires an electrode potential depending on the nature of the redox couple in solution and the ratio of the amounts of the dissolved oxidant and reductant. It responds to the changes in concentration of any component of any electroactive redox couple. Inert metal indicator electrodes are generally used to follow the progress of oxidation reduction titrations. So it is given by symbolically an equation, because since we mentioned that here redox titrations are carried out, so here the reduced form, which is already there in the ionic form, which is in the reduced form, will be oxidized to the higher oxidation state and gives n electrons. It means from this reduced form to oxidized form, it has to take place, means it do requires the presence of the oxidizing agent. Okay, oxidizing agent is essential. So here we are using the iron, which is there in the lower oxidation state, and the oxidizing agent used here is potassium dichromate solution. So when you add potassium dichromate solution to the iron, which is there in the plus 2 state, which will be get oxidized to plus 3 state. So now the relation between the electrode potential and metal ion concentration is already you have learnt in module 1, that is through Nernst equation, which gives quantitative relationship between the electrode potential and the concentration of the metal ion present in the solution, which is given by E equal to E naught plus 0.0591 divided by N into log of concentration of Mn plus, that is metal ion concentration. So this involves measurement of EMF between the two electrodes, that is platinum and calomel electrode, which are dipped into an analyte solution. Analyte solution means the solution in which its concentration is to be determined, and in turn the amount of the constituent present in that solution is to be determined. In that you are going to dip these two electrodes, that is platinum electrode, indicator electrode, and this reference electrode. So now for this combination, it is given by Nernst equation, which is again, which you are already familiar in your module 1, Nernst equation for EMF of the cell, which is E equal to E naught plus 0.0591 divided by N into log of the concentration of oxidized form to its concentration of reduced form. Again, here as we mentioned that here the redox titration is going on. So here this redox titration is taking place between the iron in the oxidation state Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus, which is brought about by the use of oxidizing agent. Here, when the moment you keep on adding the titrant from the burette used is microburette. Okay, you have taken standard potassium dichromate solution in the burette, and in the beaker you are taking this FAS solution. FAS means ferrous ammonium sulfate, means iron is there in the plus 2 oxidation state, which is added with one test tube of dilute sulfuric acid, which do requires the presence of strong acidic medium for this redox reaction to take place. So here in the beginning, when the moment you dip two electrodes, that is a platinum electrode and a reference electrode, there are no Fe3 plus ions because you have not added any oxidizing agent into it. It means it will be present with the only with the Fe2 plus. Then when the moment you start your titration, you will be noting down the initial potential. Then you will be adding the burette solution from the burette, which is taken with a potassium dichromate solution. When the moment you add potassium dichromate solution into beaker containing FAS solution, so there part of Fe2 plus will be oxidized to Fe3 plus, right? Part of Fe2 plus will be oxidized to Fe3 plus. Now this ratio exists. It means the EMF of the cell now starts increasing gradually. EMF of the cell will start increasing gradually. And it is also given by E naught as usual. It is understood. You already come across E naught is the standard cell potential of this system, which is having Fe2 plus and Fe3 plus ionic ratio. Now the EMF of this system or cell is now controlled by the ratio of concentration of this oxidized species, that is iron 3 plus, to its reduced state, that is Fe2 plus present. Okay. Now this potential will, as the sequentially, if we keep on adding the burette solution, but with the incremental addition, now this ratio keeps on changing. It means Fe3 plus in the beginning, it is less now. And when the moment you keep on adding the burette solution, that is potassium dichromate solution, so it keeps on oxidizing Fe2 plus into Fe3 plus, Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus for every incremental addition. Okay, now this ratio will decide the potential till the equivalence point. Equivalence point means the in general terms we can say end point. This is the equivalence point. Okay, till equivalence point, this ratio of this oxidized state of iron 3 plus to and iron 2 plus will decide the potential. This potential will keep on changing. Now at very close to the end point of this titration or equivalence point, which is now characterized by rapid change or large change in EMF value. So now all your Fe2 plus will be totally exhausted and it will be converted into Fe3 plus. Now this ratio will disappear. The new ratio of this ionic species will exist. That will decide the potential of the system. That is, what is that? It is Cr3 plus to Cr6 plus. Now, in the beginning, when you have added the Fe2 iron oxidizing agent, that is potassium dichromate, to this FAS solution, so it will be leading to these changes. Okay, this will be leading to this change. Now, once this all your Fe2 plus ion totally over, now only Cr3 plus will be there. And excessively, after this endpoint has arrived, you will be keep on adding the burette solution again in the same incremental addition after the equivalence point, that is Cr6 plus. It means potassium dichromate. Dichromate ion is there, no? In the dichromate ion, the oxidizing state of oxidation state of chromium is 6+. You can see this through this equation Cr2O7. Here oxidation state of chromium is 6+. Now already when bringing about this Fe2+ into Fe3+, so this oxidizing agent has oxidized this Fe2+ into Fe3+, and in turn meanwhile it has reduced its oxidation state to 3+. Now this 3+ reduced oxidation state of chromium in the lower oxidation state and chromium in the higher oxidation state. Now this ratio also will keep leading to the change in potential even after the equivalence point. Now hence the EMF of this system or potential of this system thus controlled by the ratio of the oxidized species, that is chromium in the +6 state to its chromium in +3 oxidation state which is present. Okay, so now after this is over, the equivalence point of this titration is graphically plotted with the help of derivative graph, that is delta E by delta V, that is a successive difference between the EMF, successive difference between the volume of the titrant, that is volume of dichromate solution used. Okay, so then from this equivalence point you will be calculating the concentration of the amount, that is FAS, present in the solution. So this is about theory of this experiment, principle behind this experiment. Now let us look into the instrumentation. What it contains? Potentiometer is used. This is the device which is used for the measuring the potential. It means EMF. We mentioned now potential difference between the two electrodes of the galvanic area. So this potentiometer is a device which is used for the measuring the potential. Now, and what are the other components of it? Reference electrode. We mentioned that SSE, saturated calomel electrode, which is the one of the electrodes. And second one is indicator electrode, that is platinum electrode. I already explained it under theory, under the principle of this experiment. What is indicator electrode? This is platinum electrode. Now here, known volume of the analyte, that is FAS solution, you have taken. These two are the electrodes. One is platinum electrode, another one is reference electrode. These two are connected to the potentiometer with the lead wires meant for this connection purpose. Okay, and this electrode assembly is just dipped into the solution where you have taken FAS. Okay, and the titrant is filled with this burette. The titrant used here is standard potassium dichromate solution. Now this will be added in the incremental addition of 0.25 ml each time. This is about the instrumentation of the experiment. Now let us look into the application part of it. So here we are taking the example of estimation of amount of FAS present in your given FAS solution. Okay. Now for this purpose, as mentioned in the previous slide, so you will be taking FAS solution in the beaker, okay, say about 25 ml or whatever the volume is given by the examiner, okay, and to that 4 normal dilute sulfuric acid is added. I already told that is also to be added. And now you need to immerse the electrode assembly in the beaker where you have taken FAS solution, that is analyte solution, and burette is to be filled with standard potassium dichromate solution in the microburette. Okay, now when the moment you dip these electrodes, it will show the potential, that is without addition of this dichromate solution, that is 0.0 ml. It means without adding potassium dichromate solution, you need to note down the reading, that is what the initial reading. So initial potential of the cell system. Okay, so that you have to note it down. Now you need to keep on going, adding the titrating reagent, that is a titrant in the burette, that is potassium dichromate, in the incremental addition of 0.25 ml each time. So zero is you have started, 0.25 ml you will add it from the burette into the beaker. Now in after each addition, you need to blow the solution using a straw. Straw means just like the straw what you use in juice shops for having juice. So why we have given this straw is sometimes if we use the glass rod or glass tube, there is more chances for breaking of the electrode system, because both are glass. Now, so while carrying out the experiment, there are more chances of breaking. To avoid that, we have given this straw. It means the purpose of using straw or this glass rod or glass tube is to mix the reagents properly, completely. Now, that is what is easily brought about by you even using your straw. On adding this first incremental addition, that is 0.25 ml, you have added, okay? So, you need to blow the solution slowly, gently, okay? Without making it to spurt out, okay? So, now, the rise in potential, you need to record it. Okay, initial potential was less, for example 296. Now on the moment you add 0.25 ml, it may rise to 300 something. Okay, so then next incremental addition, and that straw should not be taken out from the beaker, okay, till the completion of the experiment. So now second incremental addition, that is after 0.25, 0.05, that is 0.5 ml of the solution you have added, dichromate solution, then you need to blow it and note down the reading. Okay, here you can't wait till you get stabilized reading, because the potential fluctuation will be there. You will not be getting the stabilized reading. So what you can do is, in between the incremental additions, you can maintain some time consistency between the addition blowing and it's noting down the reading. Okay, so say about some 5 seconds you can wait, 5 to 10 seconds. You need to maintain same consistency. Okay, after each addition, blow it, wait for 5 seconds and note down the reading. Okay, so now you will be taking the readings till you will be observing, as I already mentioned in the principle of this experiment, how long you will be taking. So initially the potential of this system is because of the ratio of Fe3 plus and Fe2 plus. When the moment you keep on adding the solution at some point of volume addition, so there will be sudden jump in the EMF value after adding some amount of reagent, that is potassium dichromate solution. So now this indicates that so end point has arrived. It means it has attained its equivalence point. After this change, for example, 3 ml you added. After adding 3.5 ml, okay, 3.25 ml, so your potential has shown some drastic change rather than your previous trend of change in potential. Initially, you will be getting lesser change in potential, lesser increase in potential. For example, here after till 3 ml addition, you might have got some 590, assuming that 590. Now, when the moment you add 3.5 ml, suddenly it may change to 690 or 600 something or 700. It means some drastic change, large change in potential you will observe. Okay, after this change also, again, you need to take 5 to 6 more readings by continuing the same incremental addition of 0.25 ml of potassium dichromate. Okay, so after this, you need to stop the reading. Okay, now you need to do little calculation here. What is that? Here first value will not be there, because initial before that no other values will come. That's why it is shown with this dash mark. Okay, so now the bigger minus smaller, bigger minus smaller, it means successive difference between the EMF values you have recorded after each addition of the tight trend, that you need to write it here. It means this value minus this value, it means bigger successive difference, which is bigger, from that you will be subtracting and will be writing the delta E. Then delta V, that is a difference in volume. If you take in all this, a difference in volume comes to 0.25 ml. So that 0.25 ml is common to all. Now, this first value divided by this, that is delta E, delta V. Write the reading. Okay, write the calculated reading. Then next, second one, this value divided by this value, write down the reading. Like this, you need to keep on calculating for all these readings. Okay, then you need to record this delta E by delta V on this tabular column. Okay, in this tabular column. Then afterwards, you need to plot a derivative graph, that is delta E by delta V values on y-axis and volume of dichromate solution taken along x-axis. For example, you have started with 0, then 0.5, 1.5, like that you will be taking the scale, and here also according to the values, higher, how much higher value you are getting exactly nearing to this equivalence point, taking that as the maximum. So you need to take this 100, 200, 400, like that in terms of 100 units. So you will be getting, okay, value like this. So now you need to plot for each point incremental addition. You need to mark the points here. So initially it will be giving lesser values only here. Corresponding to this higher potential, that is drastic change, there you will be getting a higher rise in delta E by delta V. Okay, you need to mark all this. Then here also, after this rise is over, the next changes in values are also little, it will be coming slow like this. So you need to draw with a freehand smooth curve with this up to this point. Okay, and here also from the other side with this smooth curve, and from here to here you need to use scale. Okay, using this scale you need to draw a straight line, and here also a straight line. It will touch your previously connected curve, freehand curve here on both sides. Then from this peak point you need to draw one more line to this x-axis. So this gives the volume of dichromate solution required for the complete redox titration of your FAS solution. So this is also called as equivalence point. And by knowing this equivalence point, you can calculate the amount of FAS present in it. That I will show it in next slide. So here, this is what the graph. So this is equivalence point. This is the volume of dichromate solution. Now you need to do the calculation. Volume of FAS solution pipetted out into a beaker, that is 25 ml you have taken. So normality of dichromate solution is also given, which is standard solution, that also will be given by us in even examination also. So then normality of FAS you need to calculate. It is just like NV of FAS, NV of K2Cr2O7. Okay, with a simplification, NFAS we are retaining here, N of dichromate solution, that is 0.5, then volume of dichromate solution from this equivalence point through this graphical method, you'll be getting volume of FAS 25 ml you have substituted, and you need to calculate the normality. Now we need to calculate the amount of FAS present in 1 dm cube of solution. For that, normality of FAS multiplied by its gram equivalent weight of FAS, that is 392, it will give so much of grams per liter. So this is what the result you need to arrive at it. So this completes the experimental part. So next is applications. So what are the applications of this potentiometry? So this is used in maximum of the fields. It is having broad spectrum of applications because of its utility. So now let us look into those one by one. So this is finding its application in environmental chemistry for the analysis of pollutants present in water, that is in environmental chemistry for the analysis of cyanide, ammonia, nitrate, fluoride present in water and in wastewater sample also. Even if the water is appearing good, how much is there all this ionic concentration, and if it is wastewater, what are all the ionic impurities present in it, that also can be estimated by using this potentiometry. So this potentiometry, we already come across with the redox titration. It is not only useful for redox titration, it is also useful for carrying out acid-base titration, complexation titration, precipitation titration, okay, as well as for all other titration like we carry out in aqueous and non-aqueous solvents. Also, it is used in agriculture for the determination of nitrate, ammonia, iodine, calcium, potassium, cyanide, chloride, which is present in soils of various crop fields, agriculture purpose, and also in plant materials, feedstuffs, and even in fertilizers also. And it is also used in detergent manufacturing industry for the determination of calcium, how much calcium, barium, fluoride, which is present in the water. So by knowing this, they can infer at studying the effects of these ions in water quality. So this completes the potentiometry, which is coming under electrical measurement of instrumental methods of analysis.